Hey, welcome to the weekend. It is the Pregame Show Network. I'm Tolly Carr. He's Uncle Neely. Look, we're just doing it the best way we can. I'm at home, not even in the studio. Neely, it's getting serious. Practice number 9. We had our first scrimmage. Look, I didn't have time to get a whole crew together. I said, look, man, I'll pop up a camera in the garage. Let's get it done. So very bland back here. My reservoir dogs lineup. How many dogs did you see out on the field in Colorado, Boulder, Colorado today? Our first scrimmage of the spring. Your 10,000 foot overview of what you saw on Saturday.
I love the effort. I loved what I saw out there. Man, you could not have purchased better weather. Almost not a cloud in the sky. You did have some clouds move by and break up the sun every now and then, but about 74 degrees, nice little calm breeze, zero humidity. I mean, you talk about going outside for a scrimmage and having it no better. Perfect weather for it. The guys got after it. We did some miking up of Coach Flea, which is going to drop this week. It was a great scrimmage, man. I enjoyed it. I thought it was beneficial, you know, having referees out there as well.
All right. So the thing about the referees, right? Like, you know, if that little move you've been working on, like, is it legal? Have I really been holding you for these last 8 practices? Like, well, we got a lot of that clarification there today, huh?
Oh, absolutely. You know, when you go through these one-on-one matchups and now you got pads on and the guy you've been talking crap with for the past 8 practices, now you really get to go at it. But now you got to go at it in the confines of the rules, and there's somewhere they're officiating it. You know, you see it all the time in 7-on-7s and 1-on-1s, whether that's the trenches or the DBs. Is that holding? Was that pass interference? But make no mistake about it today, with an officiating crew out there, you know what it was or what it wasn't, or at least what was called. And I think that helps get people not only into spring game mode, but also when you transition into fall camp in August and get ready for real football. You've got to know how to play to your strengths, but play within the rules.
Hey, it's kind of like basketball, right? If me and you playing in the backyard, there's no free throws at all, but get referees out there. Hey, you can pick up an extra 10 points at the free throw line. So it is a part of the game when you get it with the zebras out there. So that's good to see. Neely, we had some special guests. Steve Mariucci was out there. Mark Schlereth was out there, two big names as coaches and players in the NFL, now as commentators and media personalities. The exposure, the famous faces and voices, it don't ever stop, man.
No, it doesn't. And, you know, these are personal friends of Coach Prime. Whether they played together, coached against each other, or worked at the NFL Network together, you stir it all together, man. His friends, what you and I with all this gray hair would call our Rolodex, you know, is deep, and they pull up and they come see him and support him. Those two gentlemen, they gave wonderful remarks during the team meeting that morning before the scrimmage kicked off, gave some passionate speeches and talks, you know, talking about how all eyes are going to still be on Colorado football. So never forget how much you're being watched and evaluated, whatever you do on and off the field. They were also there to watch the scrimmage take place and, you know, even share some of their thoughts with what they were seeing.
Hey, Mark Schlereth, he was a great one on that offensive line for that Washington franchise, man. Anything that he can share. Anytime you get some offensive linemen in there, I think Colorado fans are going to be pretty excited about that.
I love it. I mean, I love the way just the efficiency, the quickness, the urgency that they practice with, which is always good because it's the best way to simulate playing in a game. So urgency is important, and they play with great urgency today.
So they're looking good?
Yeah, they look great.
You look like you can still play.
As long as they don't hit me, I can play.
Go get that drum.
All right, first scrimmage, revamped offensive line. How did they look?
Look good. You know, I think that you're going to see a more consistent and cleaner pocket with this group than you had last year. But I also think that with officials being out there, that there was some calls that were made that kind of disrupted the offensive flow, but were good, you know, to have those calls being made so the lineman can learn, you know, who's going to be on the line, off the line, if you're in the tight end position, or, you know, was that a false start or was it not? There was a crucial drive in the scrimmage that was coming up, and Jordan Seaton, who was the touted freshman coming in, number one lineman in the nation, had 2 back-to-back calls on him. And so you could see the freshman showing up out of that position, but he was still dominant the rest of the day, you know, before that and after it. But having officials out there, man, with the offensive line, engaging full pad contact with the defensive line, you learn a lot about what you can do and can't do in college football.
Pancakes? Did we serve any pancakes on Saturday morning in Boulder?
I love this offensive line and their pancake ability. One thing about them, they block all the way till you're on the ground until they're using you to get up. You know, if they're not doing a push up off you and getting up and going to the huddle, they don't consider it a great block. So these guys, they know how to move. They know how to get the line of scrimmage going that way against the defense or create that pocket for Shadur to stand in. Much improved offensive lineman. I can't wait for the country to see what has been built here in Tolly. April 15th, the portal opens. Expect some more to arrive.
Oh, man, I wish I could put my taxes in the portal. Send my taxes over to Neely. I'll put my taxes in the portal. Neely is going to take care of it. We'll have to work on that. Was tempo a thing, or were they trying to like structure the pace of the game? Like, what role did the tempo play at all, if any, in today's scrimmage?
I don't think it plays any in this Pat Shurmur offense. Last year under Sean Lewis, the previous offense coordinator, he preached tempo. He wanted tempo, and it was tempo at all costs. I think Pat Shurmur's style on the offensive side of the ball is, you know, let's get lined up, let's get it right, let's do our thing. Let's pay attention, you know, eyes to the sideline for the play, that kind of thing. So it's not a slow down game. You know, they're moving, don't get me wrong, but there's not this emphasis on tempo just for the sake of moving fast. On the defensive side of the ball, you know, you hear the same thing. You hear Coach Sapp over there yelling to the defensive line, you know, let's get down, let's get ready, because the offense does not have to wait on you. So you need to be ready to go. There were a couple of substitution errors on defense as related when they could substitute when the offense didn't. But again, the refs picked that up and pointed it out. But I don't think, Tolly, that at least at this point, that tempo is the driver. Getting it right is the driver.
All right, that's interesting compared to last season, for sure. Coach Prime, did he see, he's never satisfied. He always wants more. What was his level of, you know, happy? What were his views after it was over?
I think he was a consistent, on a scale of 1 to 10, he was bouncing around on the happy meter about an 8 today. I think having his guest in and them seeing the program and also them advising him to what they're seeing, you know, he was having personal conversations, you know, with Coach Mooch about what was going on and what he thought. And I also think with the effort, you know, with the effort from the coaches, the organization, you know, that the equipment staff had, the officials and what they were doing, I think he was more than pleased with the scrimmage. There were a couple big plays by some receivers and a couple big plays by some running backs that he really got excited, you know, gave them a good pat on the back. I don't think he was let down too much on any phase of it. I think this scrimmage measured right where he would want it to be as far as the first scrimmage.
All right, so we know what Jimmy Horn Jr. can do. We know what Travis Hunter can do. Did any other names, faces, make any impressions amongst the wide receiver corps today?
Tell you what, you remember the true freshman last year who had that breakout game, Omarion Miller, who had that game that even Michael Irvin ran over to him at the end of the game, pouring into him. He had a great scrimmage today. I would give him offensive player of the day. And that's important for him to have because, you know, the receiver room is not full yet. The transfers who have committed don't get here, you know, to right around Memorial Day, and which could drop him to a number two on the depth chart. But he's not just acquiescing. He's not just saying, you know, these big dogs, when they get here, these transfers who are seniors and grad students get here, I'm just going to let them have it. He showed out today. He makes some big catches, some big plays. It's going to be an interesting battle in that QB room to see which 3, 4, or 5, depending on, you know, which personnel group we're in, really get out there on the field.
Well, I got a number two receiver here. I thought we'd get through the whole thing without my son.
But y'all should do a hair transplant. You should get some of that hair from him.
Bro, he has some lettuce. And I only have garden peas left up here. He's got some lettuce. Say hey to Uncle Neely there, man. You want to say hey to Uncle Neely? All right. I don't know how much of our YouTube audience is going to love you more than about 30 seconds. You want to go back inside? You want to do that? Because daddy would hate to have to edit this out.
The reverse psychology.
Yeah. All right. We'll just hang out here. Look, this is the style, Neely. We're bringing people fresh content.
I love
fresh
it.
Fresh might mean your son.
Speaking of fresh, I don't want the audience to miss this. You know, I don't know where the camera shots end up when we move around, but for us to unplanned, unscripted, I'm rocking a Public Enemy hoodie, and you're rocking a Biggie Notorious B.I.G. shirt.
Come on, man. Target special, baby. I got a story to tell, Neely.
We have lived long enough to see Target sell hip-hop merchandise.
My kids wear it. They don't know anything about it. My son has one. One of my daughters has one, and I have one. So we're just all biggied up around here. Neely, what's the big thing with Miller to be consistent? Because he had that game, man, where he was just the most dominant wide receiver on the field. And then we didn't see much of that for the rest of the year. What is the big part about consistency with him?
I think it's just that you just have to do it. Coach Prime is one of those coaches, man. If he doesn't see it in practice, you're not going to see it in the game, because he's not going to give you the opportunity to be featured in the game. He only believes in what he sees in practice. He believes in what he's seen you do those three or four practices, not one time in a game. I do think that Miller, you know, having now a year under his belt season-wise, but also the experience that he's gaining being right now with the twos and going against the ones. That's one thing Coach Prime loves to do. He loves the twos to go against the ones. So when Miller is out there with the two offense, he's playing against the one defense. Guess who's checking him? Guess who's guarding him? Travis Hunter. So every day when he's getting reps against the best defender he will ever face in the game. And I think you saw today when Travis was not on him, some of the workouts he's been getting going against Travis really showed up, and he was able to be there.
Did Travis go both ways in the scrimmage?
He did. If there would have been a live special teams, he probably would have gone there too. But Travis definitely played both sides of the ball and definitely made an impact on both sides of the ball.
Defensive coordinator, Livingston, Robert Livingston, his first scrimmage there, you know, bringing his elements to the table. Did you get a sense for how he felt that it went on Saturday?
Yeah, I think he was pleased. Sat down after the scrimmage, they had lunch with Pat Shermer, the offense coordinator, and Robert Livingston, the defensive coordinator. And I think they were both pleased with what they saw from their units, that there was a good back and forth depending on what each unit was trying to accomplish. You know, of course, to some degree, much like our beloved wrestling, it is scripted, but it still has to go out there and be performed. So they get together and come up with the best blueprint of installs of what they're trying to check and measure. I think both coordinators walked away from the day pleased with what they saw.
Well, if the defense and the offense will treat all their opponents like Solo Sikoa did on Friday night, I think we'll all be. Everybody got the thumb on Friday night. Neely, coming up this week, do you see things that will be areas of improvement? Did you hear any scuttlebutt about, all right, these are some things that we saw? We had live bullets. We had refs out there. We need to tighten up on XYZ starting next week.
I would say defensively getting to the ball. You know, sometimes the play is away from you. It's on the other side of the field, but you don't know if there's going to be a strip or a fumble. You don't know what's going to happen. So no matter where you are, no matter how far away you are from the play, each and every play, everybody needs to be going toward the ball. I think that's going to be addressed this week in drills and in reps. And I think on the offensive side of the ball, there were some drops with the second unit that was out there. So I think there are going to be some hand mechanisms worked on that. We have to secure catches, and we have to complete catches all the way through that catching process. And so I think that then with the penalty phase of, you know, this team was one of the most penalized teams in the nation last year, particularly pre-snap. So I think the discipline of alignment, assignment, and technique, making sure before the ball is snapped, you're where you're supposed to be, you know what your job is, and you're sitting still until that ball moves. I think all of those three things will be focuses this week.
You know, Neely, and football can be very complicated when it comes to schematics, but it also can be very simple. Well, one of the things that Coach Prime, the coaching staff, emphasize day in, day out, when you step on the field, you're running at all times. You know, being on time to meetings, to class, like all these simple things, because you can't create a scheme or hustle and effort. Like you have to be able to do those things. And as complicated as all those X's and O's, the foundation of all this stuff are very simple things.
Absolutely. And I'm glad you touched on that, Todd. That's a great point to bring up, because that is something you heard out there all day long, was no walking on the field, jog on and off, jog on and off with some purpose. So when there was a transition between offense and defense, or ones and twos or twos and threes, you know, you don't walk or tiptoe off the field. You have to jog or run off the field. You heard that repeatedly out there. And I think that you're exactly right. A lot of times, you know, you're focused on these installs and making sure people have got the right scheme down. They know where to be. But at the end of the day, Tolly, whichever team turns it over the least, whichever team blocks and tackles the best, that's who's going to win the game. So what you're going to see continue to the spring game, and even when we come back here in August, you're going to see an emphasis on blocking, tackling, and hustling.
And it seems like even what you talked about, like running for the defense to run to the ball until the whistle is blown, that seems like that is what is being like programmed into you. Like when you're on that field, there's no walking, like constant movement.
It's absolutely what's being programmed into you, Tyler. But I can admit, standing there as a spectator, it's a hard thing to remember to do, particularly when fatigue kicks in. You're on one hash. The play is at the other hash toward the boundary. The play is not over yet. And you see three of your teammates about to make a tackle. It is so easy and fatigue-wise to assume, oh, they got him. You know, no way those three guys are going to miss one guy. And the minute you think that, three guys miss one guy. Or the minute you don't get over there, one of your teammates does a strip, but the other team still picks the ball up because you didn't hustle over there just in case. So that's always going to be a point of emphasis with Coach Prime, is running to the ball.
Neely, it's all on film from last season. I remember so many plays like, oh, they got this guy tackled. What? How did he get out of there? What? He scored a touchdown.
The proof is in the film, man. And yes. Had someone just run to the ball, the outcome of the play would be totally different. And you think about what, four games that were lost by less than one score. You know, you're talking about that can really make the difference in bowl eligibility or not, is something as simple as running to the ball.
How did Shador fare against the defense and with his new offensive line? How did he look out there to you?
Look good, look comfortable. He was poised. And when you know, you got a chance to see him as a coach role when he was out of the game on the sidelines, giving instructions. So I think he was, you know, in his element on the field, in his element off the field. Of course, you know, Coach Prime is going to always, and this ain't no daddy ball, this is just how it works in college football, always reminding the defense, stay off the quarterback, you know, because it's just habitual that when you see his arm like this, somebody wants to knock the ball or grab it like they were doing in a live game. But no, stay off the quarterback. So he got all of his reps in today, as well as the others on the depth chart. But he looked good and sharp out there. I asked Mooch Mariucci, I said, you know, you have seen this from a coaching standpoint. You've seen it from a broadcasting standpoint. You know what a QB looks like. What do you see when you see Shador Sanders? He said, a QB. That's what it looks like. Like, that is what it looks like.
Absolutely. Neely, post-game meal.
Oh, today, great question. Great question. Today, the post-game, post-scrimmage meal had an Italian flair to it. There was pasta with grilled chicken chunks or meatballs. Of course, you could go with your Alfredo sauce or your classic marinara. There was also some garlic bread and other Italian. What's the fancy thing when you got like the tomato on top of the cheese, on top of the, well, you know what it's called, man. It's one of those fancy things. You're a big fancy guy.
It sounds a little fancier than Sloppy Joe's. So
no, it wasn't Sloppy Joe's, but yeah, excellent. And then on the side over there, where normally there's a burger bar, there was fried chicken, cornbread, and collard greens.
Oh, man. So you're telling me even at Colorado, there's fried chicken Saturday, not fried chicken Wednesday, not fried chicken Friday. Fried chicken Saturday.
Yeah, there was fried chicken, cornbread, and collard greens.
That's a winner. That is a winner. Well, Neely, look, I appreciate it, man. We appreciate all the fans for hanging out with us, and even appreciate you for allowing my son to barge in here three times. He's like right off camera yelling at me. So I think that's a good cue to get out of here, man. We're looking forward to it. Make sure when I say we're looking forward to it, we're looking forward to all the content that Uncle Neely got on site at today's scrimmage. A lot of big faces and voices. A lot of stuff is already on the platform. The Pregame Show Network. Neely, what's the best way for people to hook up with us, man? Because we're everywhere now.
We are everywhere. You nailed it. Hit YouTube. The Pregame Show is the name of that channel. Always go to the website, thepregameshow.com, because there's articles and other content there that are not YouTube related. And you can also find us on other social media platforms, such as Instagram and TikTok, with fresh content that are not in other places as well.
All right, I'm going to see if I can get the boy to say goodbye. Come here. Come here, boy. Come here, boy.
We're going they don't perform on demand.
All right, tell everybody bye-bye. Say bye. All right, we'll see you. He's Uncle Neely. I'm Tolly. This is the boy. We'll see you guys a little later.